You're here to study Bridgman. This is recording 3 on form from our 12-session summer boot camp in 2020. Updates are always at martialart.com. Hello, everybody. Welcome to our third installment of the Bridgman Figure Drawing Bootcamp. I'm going to go back to our first meeting to remind you to get your head into that space of why we're here. Here's why. The Bridgman Purpose Statement. This is the story of the blocked human form, where the bending, twisting, or turning of volume gives the sensation of movement held together by rhythm. Now, that isn't the purpose. This is the story of the blocked human form, where the bending, twisting, turning of volume gives a sensation of movement held together by rhythm. Let's get to the purpose. Look down here. Bridgman's purpose statement is to awaken the sense of the structure hidden beneath. Yes! Even if you do not know everything about anatomy, and you certainly won't, this is not a medical course. You know 3 things about anatomy. You know that there's a head and a thorax and a pelvis, and we think of these as things lumped together. And a lot of people don't. Most people don't. They do when they call attention to it, but they don't look at a body and see 3 chunks of bone that move in relationship to each other. That is the purpose of Bridgman, with its lively ability. And, of course, he ends with that hope that the ideas will be better, independent, and better. Good. Well, I sure wish I would have put up that slide yesterday. Now, up here, look what he has done. He has given us a line. And that line is not the base of the rib cage. This line is the base of the rib cage. And reading all sorts of things that people said at the beginning of class about how hard it was to get back to 2D thinking. Well, the whole purpose of noticing angles, there is a point of the rib cage there and a point of the rib cage there, and that's bone. Now watch this line. This is not a perfectly horizontal line going through there, almost, but not quite. But the line of the rib cage would in fact be at right angles to that. Not necessarily on Bridgman, because he may decide to take some liberty and bend it a little bit. And there actually is a little bit of bend. How much should I bend? How long will it go? Oh, wait a second. That's not the sternum. The sternum is going to start up here. This isn't three-dimensional form. I'm just looking at the shape. You see, he's actually turned that thoracic arch into something shaped like that, which has a little bit of a three-dimensionality to it. But nobody's thoracic arch is shaped like that. That's Bridgman's stylization. Now, once we get up here, we're going to do a sternum. How long would I know how to make that sternum? How would I be able to know how long to make it? Yeah. I would figure that the width of the head, if a person's rib cage looks like it's going to be about this big, then I figure that from that chart we studied yesterday, the head will be about half of that, so that ball of the head would probably be up there, about half that width, and that face might be on it like this, and that neck might come down there like that, and I've got something to start working my proportions from. Because I had what? This and this. Now, that's not three-dimensional. That's two-dimensional. Let's keep going. He's also showing us that this crunch over here, by the time we get to the pelvis, watch this, that's that anterior superior iliac spine. Here's the other one over here. And they make a line like this. So the rib cage goes like that, and the pelvis goes like that. Big difference. Exaggerated squash and stretch. In fact, this is what we did yesterday as much as we could. Can you take a front view of the body and not look at all the complex shape, but find these two shapes somewhere and see if we can look through the body? What did he call it? What did he call it? He called it the structure hidden beneath. Those two structures hidden beneath. See, but those don't look like a rib cage and a pelvis. They don't. But they're hard enough to count. And what else does he do? Let's watch. Let's watch. He says that somewhere from here and somewhere from here and somewhere down to here, it makes a convenient triangle. How does that triangle relate to my drawing? Let me show you. It puts this portion of the body on an axis that leans that way. I'll switch colors here to make the point. How about this triangle? That triangle, he is seeing. Can you see it on a body? Not really. But in his world, he says, I am seeing that triangle. And this value is that it takes us into a mode of observing not the hidden structure underneath necessarily here, but the graphic design of the figure. Now, I'm going to move on in a moment from this slide. This was about yesterday's lesson. Now, some homework. Brendan did some analysis of figures. Brendan, this was the idea. I do want to point out something I should have made a bigger deal of yesterday, and that is that a vertical line in there early on, wherever you want to place it, and a true horizontal a few places, well, we decided that the groin is halfway from the top to the bottom. And to measure how wide and how tall, look at how those verticals line up there. Look at how these horizontals do not. That tells us that if we know where one shoulder is, that we could pretty much find the other knee or shoulder by saying that one is at this level. Give me just a moment. That knee is at this level, and then you run a line that you measure to the other level. This is where that great trochanter of the femur is. Even if you didn't know that, you'd see a point there and you'd say that one goes up to the other side. And you can compare heights and widths. I should have made a bigger deal of that. I hope you went to Josh Reed's video to see him demo that, because I thought that he did a very simple job in a short amount of time. Now, every line up there has a length and an angle. And here's something Katerina pointed out, that the negative shapes become so positive emotionally. There is something about looking at those negative shapes. When we compose pictures, if we are designing anything, even a sculptor, where when you move your head around the sculpture, it's going to change altogether, looks at negative shapes and says, until they like it. And this looking at shapes, look at this. That is something that any great artist is aware of in their training. Noticing that and turning it into a little character. And that can help accuracy. That can help placing things correctly as well as designing so that it looks nice. Bridgman was certainly aware of it. Now, Brendan went a little bit beyond the call of duty. That is three-dimensional. That's what we're studying today. Today, I am going to do this about 20 times. Watch what I do over here on the right. I'm going to tell you, as some of you have been in my classes in school, that that's a something. That's a block. It isn't a block yet, but it will be. And am I looking up at it or down at it? Well, I see underneath it. So I'm figuring that the convex rubber band that wraps that way is going to tell me that I see this part down there. And is it spun to my right? Yeah, it's spun to my right so that I'd see over there on that ear. So I could put a center line on it that way, or I could shave off that plane. And that is enough to help me find the three structure lines that will design a three-planed, six-planed actually, but three that are visible when it's tipped like this box. The vertical line, the oblique line, the horizontal line. I'm going to do that a whole bunch of times today. If you're brand new to it, it might hurt. If you're not brand new to it, I hope it's going to propel you to do further. And in a week or so, we're going to turn that neck into something that would wedge into there and then try to find the muscle that would go from there and then into there and the other one that's going to wrap around and do some development into anatomy. Now, Brendan, you're here. I don't have mic access, but I spent a lot of time thinking about these. It was fun. Bless you, Brendan. You know that a person is on their way to doing good work when they say, I spent a lot of time and it was fun. It doesn't mean that if it wasn't fun, you won't do well. Everything's not fun sometimes. But if you're spending a lot of time and enjoying it, that's the great secret. Okay, good job. Romana did something that is the foundation. This stuff that Bridgman shows us in the book when he shows you the cross sections of a body from top to bottom. Why? So that you can have an intellectual exercise? Say, I'm smart. I know the cross sections of the body. It's not why. It's a hidden structure, not so hidden when you're an artist. It's to create your own light source. Cross sections allow you to define the form without shading. And then when you decide to put the light here or the light there, you've got a rubber band around there or a little cross contour around there. See, this faces up. This faces down. No, it doesn't. It's all one flat screen surface. Yeah, but in our pretend world, we put a line like that and a line like that, and we have, in that pretend world, something facing this way that receives light, something facing this way that doesn't. That is the shortest and simplest I can explain of how planes give the illusion of rendered form when you know the cross sections in all directions. Okay, Romana, good job. Now, let's take a look at a few more, and we'll spend less time on these, and we're going to move on. But I want you to see what students are doing, and I hope this is useful to you. Sasha did three studies. One of them is full of planes and shading. One of them is fewer planes without shading and showing us that we see this side. Let me darken that. We see this side, and this is another side over here, and this is a third side over here, like a block. And then when we come up here, that side disappears because her torso is twisted to where this is facing more down that way, and that is facing more toward us. And over here, rhythm and continuity lines. And one line that might flow into another, and another that might flow in another, and straight line angles. Good job, Sasha. This is homework that takes time and that drills into our habits and perception. But this is the one I'm going to land on. This is the one we're going to take the rest of the session today to deal with. Sudipta. Look what Sudipta is doing here. Two studies. One of them is what you'll do tonight and for the coming week. Three big forms. We're going to understand that. But just in case there's a temptation to say it's all about form, no, it isn't all about form. It's also about graphic design. And if you do this and you say it's a little stylistically and technique-wise, it looks a little careful, that's okay. Because I predict that Sudipta, in paying attention to these skills, will eventually go in there and say, like that, like that, like that, like that. And also maybe even when it comes to the pen and ink or some other medium that allows you to go thick and thin by pressing down, you'll start with a thin one and then get really thick, and you'll have a line quality that is like a musician running the bow across the violin strings or the cello strings and getting some guts out of them. But these things take time and a lot of energy, and that's what you're here for. This is the month that you do it. Now, we've spent a lot of time on that one. What was the point of it? More than one way to approach this. Robert Beverly Hale, many things at once. Conscious mind can't do it. Subconscious mind must. How must subconscious mind? Spending a lot of time, a month or a few years, acquainting the subconscious mind with these different disciplines. And what we deal with now is what I told you we would, the thickening of the figure through forms and variations. All right, what does Bridgman call them? He calls them the three masses. It's a Catholic term. Better change that. The three forms. In one of his books, Constructive Anatomy, the first book, or one of the, it was, I think, the first book, 1920, he says in there, these three forms, think of them as the body of a wasp with only one line connecting them, or without reference at all to connecting portions. Really? You'd make a head and a rib cage and a pelvis and not even care about the spine that connects them? Or even a line that connects them? No, just floating wasp parts. Well, that's an interesting observation. Floating wasp body parts. That could be useful. I never noticed it before, but even though those wasp sections are connected by the spine, as much as that spine can move, the muscles will take it there, and we'll get to the muscles later. Ah! Now look what we've got. Three parts. Each one of these boxes, as we said, is in a different position. We're looking at that top box. We're looking up into the base of it. We're looking up into the base of this one, the chest, and we're looking up into that pelvis. All three of them we're looking up. Hey, this one we're looking level with. We're looking up at the chest, and we're looking, what about that? We're looking down at the head. Now, that explains why these three forms are the core forms we study in studying the figure. And because this is facing a different way than this one's facing, and this is facing a little different too, every one of them is different, we've got to have three ways of doing this. Here is where we get serious, and here is where you need some paper, because we're going to spend a good deal of time on this slide, but you're going to learn. I'm going to teach. I hope you're going to learn. Everything on the head, in this case, everything on the head gets lumped into one box. You say, but doesn't part of the head move? Yes, there is a joint right there called the temporal mandibular joint, and that jaw can open up and clench down. So aren't we going to account for that? No. We are going to lump the whole head in there so that wherever that block goes, that head will go. Everything about the chest, the thorax, that's what they call it with a wasp body. Everything gets lumped into one box, but doesn't the thorax change shape when you breathe in and breathe out? Your doctor cares about that. She'll put a megaphone or a stethoscope on there to listen to what happens when we breathe, but artist, don't want to worry about that to start out and make it too complicated. What about this pelvis? Unless you are giving birth, that pelvis is rock solid, and everything about it will fit into a block. Okay, now we understand why we're doing this. These three masses, each one has its own set of, what's the word? Coordinates. Its own set of lines. These lines, complex as they are, can be turned into simple systems. Let's do a little drawing of the head, tipped down a little bit, so that we know that this head is in a different position. It's aiming down. The eyes would be there. The ear would be there. The nose would stick out there, cast a little shadow. The eye sockets would cut in. The chin would be there. Just want to give you enough to see that's going to be, that could be eventually, a head. Now, what about that chest? Well, let's do what he does. We're looking down at that head. What if we were to look up at that chest? We're going to make the front plane there, and we're going to look slightly up at this. Is that possible? Maybe not. But I'm going to go ahead and do it. And then that pelvis, let's do something really hard to do. Let's look down at the pelvis and make it overlap. Let's make it overlap a bit. with the box for the rib cage. When we name the three line systems, we have to do something that won't confuse us. We're going to call left to right. We're going to color it red here. Every line that goes left to right, we're going to color it red, and we're going to name it X. Well, why name it X? That's confusing. Why not just say left to right? Here's why we don't name it left to right. Because look at the drawing at the left, and look what these X lines will look like over here at the left. Watch this. There's an X line. There's an X line. There's an X line. There's an X line. It's going into the paper. It's not going left to right on the paper. It's going into the paper, and so we don't want to call it left to right. We don't want to call it a width line, because what about positions where it has no width on the paper? What if it's pure depth over there on this figure? Pure depth. So we'll call it X. Now there's another line, another one of these three line systems, and it is for height. We'll color it blue because it goes up to the sky, which today in Southern California may be sweltering. We're in a desert. But the sky is, in my view, blue. Hey, look over here at the left. They stay height lines. The Y line is for up and down. And when we swivel it, we see them in all of their up and downness. I'll be doggone. Now, what if they don't go up and down? What if a person is lying down, reclining, and the up and down lines go perfectly horizontal? Well, you don't call them up and down lines. So what do we? That's why we call them Y. Because that way they stay consistent no matter which way they swivel. We got one more set. And that would be the ones that go from front to back, the depth lines. Now, over here on the left, we're coloring them green. Those depth lines, which we will call Z, can we see them on the front view? Well, we'd see a little green dot that goes back on the depth of the figure, but we would not see them as a line system. Hey, how come the blue lines never had a point where they made a dot? What view would the blue lines make a dot? Right, top down. We were looking straight down on this, the blue lines would make a dot. I'm going to go ahead and do it. And then the depth of this head from above would have lines like that. Those are the Z lines. And the width of this head from above would go across like that. And then we could draw, so that you'll know what I'm doing, in case, well, Marshall drew a box, supposed to be the figure. Watch this. The ears would stick out like that. The nose would stick out like that. And the shape of the head as it fits in the box would be something like that. A little narrower at the front. You get the idea. We have just named the three axes, the three coordinates, you want to take a screen grab of that, feel free to do it. But if you're drawing this on your paper, getting it on a screen grab isn't going to help you nearly as much as getting it into your brain. And to do this several times, and I recommend, you know this if you've taken other classes with me, and I'm sorry that every time I teach anything having to do with draftsmanship, I always bring this up. But when my son was 5-6 years old, and he wanted me to teach him something about perspective, and I taught him a little. 5-year-old brain is not fit for understanding abstract concepts like perspective. But he did understand that X was width, Y was height, Z was depth. And we looked at pictures to see if we could name it. And the way we did it was X, Y, Z. And to get that into you, to get into thinking about those things, you're thinking about the axes. Okay, I'm going to pause for a moment. This is why Bridgman says that this is the story of the blocked human. This is the story of turning the human body into blocks. Well, why turn it into blocks? It's not made out of blocks. It's made out of round things. Yeah, round things, as you're going to see in a few moments here, are really tough. Now, some of you might say, why do some 3D apps swap out the X and the Z? I don't know why. But it doesn't make any difference. You can name these anything. You can name these three line systems Eric, Shane, and Rembrandt. It doesn't make any difference as long as we keep them consistent so that we can track where we are with these forms. Now, I should say, those of you who are perspective students, those of you who are concept designers who do environments, those of you who work with 3D programs, you already know this. I am trying to do this for a person who is a beginner. I'm trying to do this for a sixth grader so that you understand the concept, and I hope I didn't hurt you too much. But those of you who know more about it, know that the environment has a whole different set of coordinates. When you lie down, you lay down, the room will have an X, Y, and Z, and the things in the room can tumble all over the place. But that's exactly why we use this. This is a left-brained, scientific way of understanding three-dimensional space by reducing it to the three dimensions. Width, height, depth. Okay. Now, Bridgman, in the book, even includes inches. Those of you in other countries of the world who know about the better measuring system, I don't want to take responsibility for my country, and I don't want to take responsibility in a number of reasons, for a number of reasons. One of them is why this country did not adopt the metric system, which when I heard about it, I was a kid when I heard about it. Why don't we do that? That's easier to learn. No, it cost too much money. So Bridgman, in his book, in the United States in the early 20th century, actually reduces these things or describes these things in their inches, which is not that helpful, actually, because it's relative to the size you're working. But there he's showing us something. Now, I want to see if we can apply this or see how he does it in his pictures. Let's take a moment to see. Well, sure enough, this analysis, Bridgman is showing us this is not just something we do in a textbook. I'm going to actually draw a figure here, and I'm going to turn it into three separate things, and I'm going to make one that I'm looking up at, and another that I'm looking up at, and another that I'm looking down on. Now, look what I did. The logic is that if this end of a cylinder is closer to me, the rubber band, watch the rubber band, very important that you're watching right now, it curves convex to the direction that it's going away. Oh, I got the axis of this one all wrong. That's okay. The axis is actually going straight up and down. I've got it going that way. But this end is closer to me, so the line will curve convex as it goes away. Whereas over here, this end is closer to me. You say, Bill, I can't see into it on a real human body. That's okay. We're trying to think of something that says that's closer. And if it were a cylinder, the line would curve that way as it goes away, convex as it goes away. So I made a convex line, and that got me started with three-dimensional lumps. Yesterday, we talked all about shapes. Today, we are talking about forms. I'm going to switch to blue here, and I'm going to do these again. I'm going to do this one. We're going to say we've got a something there that's a shape, something like that. And we've got a something here that is a shape, something like this. And we've got a something here that is a shape, something like this. Now, that may not be very accurate, but here's what I'm trying to see. I'm trying to see that he's thinking that way even more. Let's get it a little better. He's thinking that that thing is, that pelvis is angled that far. So I might want to take into account that the, what line system would this be? Let's think, what line system would this be if it's going from one side to the other? That has got to be an X line going off to the X line vanishing point. Well, my goodness, if I've got that X line because I went through side to side, I can be pretty sure that every line on that block that goes that direction is going to go that direction. I made it blue. That's okay. I'm just going to make it blue. We'll swap out X and Z, or no, Y and X in this case. Now, what about depth? Well, how would I know that the depth, which I'm going to use as another color, how would I know that the depth would go this way? I don't. In fact, that block might even be, watch this, the depth of that line, if that's the width line, the depth of that block might be going that way. That might be a better interpretation. Let's see. That would mean that we were actually, if we could see through that leg, we'd be looking up a little at that block. You say, well, Marshall, if I'm going to do these studies this week, how do I know which one? Play with them. If this were a real figure in real three-dimensional space and not an invention George Bridgman was doing while he was standing in front of a group of people, there'd be an objective truth about it. But it's a drawing, and he might have changed his mind from top to bottom. Hey, here's what it means. It means that if we go from there and aim back there, and then we could see the hidden lines. Well, I think we better switch to green then for the height lines. And we're going to do that, and that, and that. And we have got a something now that whatever it's missing for organic qualities, it's certainly not missing anything for telling us the position of that mass. This we are definitely looking up at. I'll just switch to black now so that I don't have to keep switching between. Look over here from that corner. Let's see, somewhere around here over to there tells me that that width line is going to go like that. So I'm going to say that this block has got to be in a position like that, maybe even tighter. I'm not daring to exaggerate as much as he did. And I'm going to look up at that block. And that looks enough like what George Bridgman is getting at. And then that head, let's see, if I could put a center line on there, it's going in the same direction that this line is. instead of a center line, I'm going to try finding the edge of that block and I'll go like this. But now the lines are not going, the depth lines are not going away from me to the left. They are going away from me to the right. And so I would build a block where I'd be looking up underneath it. And now we have a head in a different position than the chest. I'm going to pause for a moment.
Hey, Marshall.
Yes.
I'm seeing a great question. Is it Palin?
Yeah.
The question is, are these X's, Y's, and Z's parallel to other X, Y's, and Z's if we think of them in perspective?
They are parallel to every X, Y, and Z on that block. Not to any other X, Y, and Z's. When a block is tumbling, when this block is in this position, it doesn't know anything about the position this block is in. And then if I'm going to move it into this position, it doesn't know anything about that. So each block carries its own set of axes. Now, does that answer the question, or did that make it more confusing? Sarah says, I struggle finding the z-axis for boxes. They can go so many ways. Yeah, that's why. That's why perspective takes 6 months to a year of concentration. But you already know my opinions on that. We did a whole hour-long podcast or so on how to study perspective. I'm trying to give you a very beginning perspective introduction right now. And horizon lines aren't coming into it. Well, yeah, they are kind of. Why? Let's give a little bit of attention to that. Let's go back to this one. Oh, that's a good one. Hey, where's the horizon line? Well, let's find it. The horizon line must be somewhere here. He's kind of sloppy, but these are definitely meeting somewhere down here. Okay, I got it. The horizon line is there. Now, that means that, hey, why is that one aiming up? Have I made my point? This box doesn't know anything about this box's horizon line. Oh, is it saying my eye is up here? No. It's saying that you can have a box that is level. Let's do it. Let's do it three ways. A box that is level. A box that is a little below our eye, a box that is well below our eye. Now watch what I do. A box that is above our eye, and you say, I got it, it all makes sense. But watch this. A box down here that is also above our eye. How did that happen? Because this box doesn't know anything about this box. Every box is different. Now, if that became confusing, I'm going to put it on you. The confusion is that you are so locked onto the thing perspective teachers tell you at the beginning. I do too. You have to know where the horizon line is. That's where you start. That's where you start when you're creating an environment. It's not necessarily where you start when you're creating a head, because the horizon line might be down here. And you say, it sure is. If I turn that into a box, it's going to go down to there. I got it, Marshall. What about if the person puts their head down? What about if a person tilts their head down? It doesn't work anymore. So a better question then where is the horizon line is this. Am I looking up at this head? Yeah, that means I'll see underneath it. Is it facing to my left or right? Looks like it's facing to my left. Therefore, I'll put a line like that. Now, one of you said, that Z line is so confusing. But you see how just by doing that, saying I can see underneath it, I could snap that rubber band tight and snap that rubber band tight, and lo and behold, it's not going to be accurate that way, but it's going to be useful. What about this one? Even if my eye is down here at the leg, if that person puts their head down, I can say that head. Which part's closer? The top is. Okay, I'll shave off that top and I can see it. Now I get a corner, snap that rubber band tight. Watch this, those of you who have trouble with a Z line. It looks right. How did you know it was right? I didn't know it was right. I've just drawn a lot of blocks. And if you draw a lot of blocks, you start to say that looks right enough. Nicholas has summed it up. Nicholas asks, so when we are creating these boxes forms, we are creating three distinct forms. Yes! Do we technically not need to worry about horizon lines at all? No, we don't need to worry about them practically at all. Isn't it necessary to make sure that three forms look coherent in relationship to each other? Well, you're putting something on it that we don't need. Is this head not coherent with this one? Is this head not coherent with this one? Three separate forms. Now, the reason why I think people get confused is that you're sticking with a maxim. Got to know where the horizon line is. You do. When you're plotting out perspective in an environment, it's the first thing practically. But when you're spinning a block around, I want you to know that when I spin this block around, rough as I'm drawing it, I know that this is not impressing you. This is worse than a lump of barbecue charcoal. But I can spin it so that this side comes more toward me and looks like this. Now watch what I do. Those of you who have trouble with the Z lines, it was aiming that way. This one was aiming that way. But if I'm going to pull it down there so that now it's aiming more level, doesn't it make sense that this one's going to go more up and that plane will become more foreshortened? Can I do it further? Am I thinking of a vanishing point? No, just thinking that direction. Can I make it so that it's almost a side view? Yeah, let's do it at almost a side view. Make it so that this is even a little more horizontal. And then that goes very straight up. And now it's just a little sliver of what was a front plane. Terrible perspective, but it works. It's spinning it. What would happen if we spun it all the way over that way? It could end up looking like this. It sure could. Now, we spun this over to there, and it landed here, and it came from there. And then we say, I don't like to look down on it so much. Watch this. I'm not going to look down on it so much. I'm going to bring it up a little closer to my eye level. Say, that's a horizon line thing, right? Watch this. I'm going to bring it up a little closer to my eye level, and I'm going to make that line that was going up there that way go a little less up. Ooh, now I'm not looking up at it so much. Can I bring it up further? Yeah, I'm going to bring it up further to where I lift it up over my head. Like that, it's the same thing. There was that, and now it's up there. And can I spin it so that I see more of this side? Yeah, let's do that. Let's spin it so that we see more of that side. And now the X is over here, and it's going to be less of that and more of this O over here, and so on and so forth. Were you thinking about horizon lines? Sort of. I was thinking about the lines go up. The lines go up when you're looking down on it. The lines go down when you're looking up at it, and the lines go both ways. A little up and a little down when you're looking level at it. Draw a box is the foundational. Draw a box is a place that I have not gone through the exercises, but the thinking is all of this. And modern day James, too, takes you through this. Jonathan asks, can I mark X, Y, I, and Z on the figure I drew at the right? Was that a long time ago? Yeah, that was 20 minutes ago. Sorry, Jonathan. But hey, Jonathan, how about you mark them? If a five-year-old can do it, width across any part of the body is X. Height any part of the body, even if it's lying down, we're going to call that Y. Depth, anything that goes from the front toward the back of the body, we're going to call it Z. Oh, well, Kate, yes, I can clarify that. What does this corner represent? You know what it represents. It represents the corners of the rib cage, more or less, not exactly. What would the sternum look like? Something like that. What does this represent? It represents the corner of the pelvis. I'm a little confused. Does each box have its own horizon line? Yeah. So that means I have to draw a horizon line for each one? No. I'm going to erase this and start over again to see if I can clarify. This will be a last point about this. Let's go to blue. If I'm going to draw a box that I'm looking down on, any line that goes away will go up. Was I thinking about a horizon line? No. I was just figuring I want to see the top of that box. How will I see the top of that box? I'll have to run a line up. What if I wanted to see the bottom of the box? Well, if I want to see the bottom of the box, I can't run a line up or I won't see the bottom of the box. I'm going to have to run a line down to see the bottom of the box. So yeah, there might be a horizon line down there, but I'm sure not thinking about vanishing points. I'm just aiming in a direction. Now the same thing, if that's the front of the box and I want to see less of the front, what if I wanted to see the back of the box? Watch what I do. I would spin these lines. There's only three lines so that the back of the box, presumably over there, now shows itself over here. Okay, we need to move on. Let's see. The horizon line is located in the environment. The mass of the body have perspective and relation together. Good, Clarice. Forget the horizon line for now. That's only important if all the boxes are exactly in the same orientation. I think I made that point when I pointed out the horizon line for all four of them. Our eye can be down there. We're lying on the beach, and these are people who are walking. We're looking up at all of them. How can I, if they're looking up at him, how can I do that? Watch me. You're looking up at me. The camera is right at the level of my mouth. So you're looking up at my forehead. Now watch. I can tip that bald head toward you and you're looking down on me. Oh, I can't understand that. What happened to the horizon line? Just think of the boxes, not the beach and the ocean and the environment. Bridgman is telling us the rib cage is shaped like a circle from the front. It certainly isn't shaped like a circle from the side. Remember what it's shaped like from the side? It's shaped a bit like a flattened egg. And then that pelvis is quite blocky, especially when you get flesh on it. And then that football, and then that calf, and then that foot. That got us going. But from the front, it's shaped a bit like, enough like a circle to him. And if it's anatomically accurate, it would be shaped like an egg with the small part at the top. He is simplifying and stylizing. But look what we find out here. Now I'm going to talk about the three sections. First of all, let's start with a very quick drawing of three rib cages, thinking of them as eggs. This is a rib cage, and I'm going to look up at it. And there is a sternum on there that, if it were a complete egg, would go like that. And another section, this wide part, eighth rib is the widest part. Watch what I do. I'm going to put a rubber band that way. It goes like that. How did I do that? Well, that was sophisticated perspective, I'll tell you. But that's just one. Now we're going to do something facing the other direction and looking down on it. We're going to see into the top of the rib cage. We're going to put the sternum there like that. And we're going to say that we are, let's wrap a rubber band around it. That would be a transverse section. Put a corner of a rib cage there and a corner of a rib cage there. And we're going to see, can we make this look like we're looking down on it? We can. We got one we're looking up at and it faces up to our right. One we're looking down at and it's facing over to our left. And let's do this one where we're almost level with it, maybe a little below our eye. You say, how do you mean below our eye? I can see into the top of it. I'm going to deal with that in a moment. Remember that from the side view, a rib cage has a longer back and a shorter front. A shorter front and a longer back. That's too big a rib cage, but life goes on. Now that means, watch this, that angles down. So even if our eye were right here, if our eye level were right here, we'd still see down into that. And then we put a sternum on there, a single line will do. And then we look for something like a corner of the rib cage. That might be one, and that might be, hey, look, watch this. If that's a corner and the other one is a corner over there, we're guessing at what they are. The line aims up. That means I could put a dot there and a dot there, and that would tell me that I'm looking ever so slightly at a corner. Watch how it makes sense when we turn it into three line systems. Ever. Not looking down that much, but you get the idea. And then we're going to find a way to curve that line and curve that line and give ourselves something that will look three-dimensional. Now, the quality of these drawings using the Zoom drawing tools, which I do apologize for it, because I know those are the line quality is just abominable. But that might be the best way to do it. The lump of barbecue charcoal to just show you line like this, line like that. Beautiful lines can happen with you or later. Now we're going to do this slowly. And I'm going to do it bigger. And I'm going to explain each point. And I'm going to start. Those ones that I just did, I started with an egg. I started with something like that. put a rubber band around it. That tells me I'm looking down on it. Watch the pencil. Watch the pencil. Don't be drawing right now. Watch this. I could say that that's the center and it's facing toward me, but I'm not saying that. I'm going to say that the center is right here and it's facing to my right. Oh, the cross contour. That sagittal section did it. And then I want something similar, but at a 90 degree angle so that I've got all three sections. You can do that too, but you'll do it easier with about 10 to 20 hours of concentration on boxes and ellipses. So don't kill yourself if you can't understand that. I'm doing it simply to show you that it can be done without a lot of fuss, but now I'm going to do it with a lot of fuss. Let's put this rib cage into a box on which we look down. How do you know that we're looking down? Because the lines that go away go up. Are we looking extremely down on it? Take a look at it. We're looking down enough on it. How do you control how down you look on it? How up the lines go. The more up they go, the more you're looking extremely down on it. This is right in between. And I've only been thinking of three line systems. Up and down. The ones off to the right. The ones off to the left. Now, here's a very important thing. That if you don't do this transparently, so that you can see the lines on the other side, if you don't do that, you will not be able to make these anything like precise. Now, if I'm going to fit a rib cage into there, I think that I'd need to know what it looks like if I look down on it. For example, there's going to be a small opening at the top like that. I might want to find a small opening at the top and see if I can, hey, this might be helpful. Let's get it in the center so that it's in perspective, and putting a line that I'm trying to pay attention to and say that's landing right in the center on the, watch this, on the front, it's centered left to right. On the top, it's centered left to right, more or less. On the bottom, it's not exactly centered, but it's close enough. And on the back there, it's centered enough. Gosh, I should probably do that along the, what plane would this be? We're going to use the terms now. This section is the sagittal plane. It's the plane that is shaped like this. If you carve a little section out of it that's like a credit card standing up, that is the sagittal plane. Hey, do we need another section? I think we should have another section. I think we should have a section. And since the widest part of a rib cage, not in Bridgman's world, but in reality, you're studying more accurate human anatomy, is a little below, not in the center. So I'm going to do a line like that, and a line like that, and a line like that. And I'm going to see if every one of these lines, if I can keep them in track, that section will be the transverse section. I'm going to draw it again over here so there's no question that is the section I just drew. That is the transverse section. Let's colorize that sagittal section. We've got one more section, don't we? I wonder if anybody knows what it is. I wonder if you know what it is. That would be the one that wraps three-dimensional world, so you can put three bits of wrapping twine around this box. That will be the coronal section, the one that, if it's around your head facing forward, stands up like a crown. And that is this section. Coronal. How does that help me, Marshall? Let me show you. If we decide that on the top of this box, there's an opening for that rib cage, but it doesn't lay flat. Remember, it angles like this. We might want to either watch the dot. We might want to pull this part down, or we might want to lift this part up. Now, I can tell if I lift this part up, I'm going to make it real tall, but the reason I'm going to lift it up instead of pulling this down is that it will be easier to see what I'm doing. So I might make a tall, skinny rib cage, but do you see how I'm going to do that? And then I connect with a little knowledge of ellipses. I connect something that's going to be like the opening of the top of that rib cage in perspective. What do I need to do now? Now I need to find where that sternum would be. Well, this is not touching the front. The sternum might touch the front, say, right about here. And watch this line. I can go from there to there, and I've got a line for the sternum. What about the widest point that's out here? What if I put a dot right there for that widest point? That's why I put the little piece of string around there. Where will it be on the other side? Watch my pin. If I take a ride on X and go over there and touch the other side where that rubber band went all the way around, hey, I could go from, say, this side point, and that's going to give me a portion of the coronal section, the other one over there, like that. What about that transverse section? Well, I know that the transverse section aims back there and aims back there, and if I were to smooth this out, I know that it cannot go outside of the box, so watch what I have to do. I'm going to have to get back over to that other side. And where is the corner of the rib cage? Let's place the corner of the rib cage about that height and back in there about an eyeball, about that height and then back in there about an eyeball, right about there. And I can begin to bring down, I'm doing this line right here, bring down a transverse line, like a line around the globe, and connect crucial dots. Here's a tough one. What do I do with that? That's over on the other side. But I would bring a line that would connect from that corner of the rib cage up to this part of the silhouette, and from this portion that I guessed right here up to this part of the silhouette. And then cross contours. There we've got an opening of the rib cage. We've got a coronal section We've got a couple of transverse sections. And we've got a sagittal section, which we can now make into something more like a sternum. And then get the outer contours. Now, we've only got 15 minutes left. And I told you I was going to give you permission to not do all of this work. I also will give you a link. If you want to see me do this more on YouTube, some of you already have. I'll put it in there before we finish. Now, I'm going to look at questions. If you want to build that three-form box that you made, what materials work best? Well, here's what I did, because he suggested do it. He said, but that doesn't look like a body. I know. But for those of you who were confused, what about the horizon line? And do they all have to point to the, and how come this at least makes one point? If this is a head and this is a rib cage, the head knows not what the rib cage does. And vice versa. If this is a rib cage and this is a pelvis, the blocks that represent them have nothing to do with each other for their line systems because they can be bent all over. That's why you would take two blocks that have nothing to do with human proportion. I'd kind of like to have some blocks that look like human proportion. I went to Michael's and I put more work into this. I don't like carving. I'm not a sculptor. But I measured stuff out and I took my time and I glued things together and I put flexible wire in there so that at least this, which is, notice, that's not Bridgman's rib cage. That's closer to Richet's. So how long does it take to build one of these things and put that wire in it? If you want to do it so that you've got something to work from, if you want to do it, what do you figure? That's up to you. I spent about 4 hours on it, maybe. Cutting it out of sponge sure makes it easier. All right. Your homework this week is going to include to find every image in the book that shows a simplified form and give it some thought. You will not master it this week. It takes perspective training to master perspective. But you'll get familiar with it. You will start to notice, if you work on this, you will start to notice that if you have a ball or an egg in front of you and it's looking right at you, that line will be straight. But if you turn it away from you, it's going to start to curve that way. Now watch the next thing. Over on the other side, transparently, it will repeat that. Am I looking up or down at that? I don't know yet. I haven't put a line on there. You have to put a transverse line. That's a sagittal line. But if I have a transverse line that from the front view might just look like that, I can then say, oh, and I'm looking up at it. Now watch this and try to draw over to the other side so that you see the whole transparent thing. What if I did the same thing, spun the same amount, but I'm looking down on it? Let's do that. We're going to now look down on it, and you can look over to the other side and then run that sagittal line like so. And the more that we spin it, the more that we spin that egg so that that center line goes over there, the more over on the other side that line will reach it. Until eventually, this center line would become the contour, the coronal line, which was going north to south pole, but through the side. Eventually, that will face us directly. And the center line, the sagittal line, will go all the way over there. So a good deal of what you're going to do this week is find all sorts of these and see if you can work on it for several hours until it happens. Maybe not this fast. Looking up at that head, look what he did. Got a line like that. Seeing underneath that chin. And is it facing this way? No, it's facing this way. Get that sagittal line. There's a transverse line. Do we need a coronal line? The ear would be right there. Yeah. Now I got a form, and I can turn it into a block because I've got my three line systems, and there's no question, as sloppy as that is, it faces up to the left. I look up into it, and the ear goes the other way. What about this chest? This chest, I'm looking up at it, no question, and the center line is right along there. And what about that pelvis? I'm going to say that I'm looking down at it. I can just start with anything that looks three-dimensional. And then I'll say, it isn't the case here, but I'm just going to go in and do it because the line curved that way. I've got something like that. To get to the point where after you've done, how many of these should you do? I am telling you, for your assignment this week, that you should do 40 analyses of Bridgman bodies, reducing the three masses, head, thorax, and pelvis, into three transparent blocks. 40? That means 120 drawings, boxes. Yeah. Boot camp. 40 figures, 120 boxes. If you're really ambitious, 3, 4, 5 minutes per box. Try to draw them transparent, where you do the lines on the other side. But they'll be terrible boxes. They'll be better. They'll be better toward the end, probably, especially if you take breaks. I have opinions about how to do this. If you do this for 2 or 3 hours at a time, you can hurt yourself. Your drill sergeant caring about your exercise. Do them 20 minutes at a time, and if it's hard, take a break. Have some fun. Watch cartoons. Oh, by the way, if you watch cartoons, especially classic cartoons, you'll be amazed at how animators in the 1930s and 40s, amazed at how they had this wired. Then come back, work for 20 minutes again, and do that 15 times between now and next Thursday. That's probably the better way to go. But some of you have personalities where you say, I can't work for 15 minutes. I need to work for a full hour. Okay. Do that. That's all. That's all you've got to do this week. But if it was easy, try redrawing 20 of them and reduce them to organic transparent forms. That's harder. Say, I need more instruction. I'm going to give it to you. I'm going to give it to you in 7 minutes. I'm going to give you a link so you can watch me draw spheres based on boxes on YouTube. It's a short video, but it's the best I ever did it, and it's done roughly with a camera, and it'll make the point. Now, if you say, Marshall, I've done this so many times. This is too easy. I wanted a boot camp. And you're saying, well, run around the yard 3 times. No, no, no. If you want an advanced task, try redrawing at least 3 of these in the same poses, but swivel the camera around 90 degrees or lift the camera up or pull the camera down. That is a challenge. That's what you would have done at the Art Students League in Kimmo Nicolaitis' class in a life drawing class. You wouldn't copy the model. You'd interpret what would it look like from 90 degrees, and you draw it from imagination, then you go over there and you correct it, and you do that until you find out there's no way to solve that without turning it into simple forms. Blocks where you swap out X and Z, cylinders where you say, let's see, that is going up, and it's also a little out, so if I were over there, it would be going up, but it would be coming toward me instead of going out. That takes tremendous analysis, and those of you who had headaches from yesterday, Don't give it a try. You will damage yourself. Okay, I have written down some page numbers here. Might want to screen grab that. That's in the Complete Guide 5th edition. That are some really good ones to work from. Where he's doing the work for you. Bridgman, I'm not showing you that many drawings in here. Bridgman's got a lot of them in there where he's doing the work for you. And they don't all have to be blocks that are proportionally correct. Look at how that one includes the broadness of the shoulders. Look at how this one includes a made-up form that we haven't even dealt with. It's not a block. It's a wedge. Okay. That's your assignment. You might say, I kind of wanted to draw beautiful figures. I kind of wanted to come in here and learn to draw like Bridgman. Well, I'm going to tell you, you do not get yourself in physical shape by getting on one of those machines that jiggles you around. The way you get in shape is you run, you lift weights, you play tug of war, you do that, all that stuff. And it isn't all pain. Just look these things over. Try to understand them. Draw them without too much concern for accuracy. You care more about the fact that axes and sections exist than about getting them perfect. Block and ball. Cylinder and wedge. Cone. Look at how he does it. There it is. Look at that line. Like so. Lines go down. Lines go down. I'm looking up into that box. This one's pretty much doing the same thing. There's a line like that, lines go down, that means we've got our box. Oh, change the rules over here, now we're looking down on it. There's the corner, lines go across and up, that means we're looking down into it. And he'll do the same thing with every limb. This leg over here is coming toward us, and we might see a little bit of that side of it. And so we'll see a little bit of that anatomy over there. There is Bridgman teaching us how he does these rock strong drawings. There is Bridgman showing us that he's putting the two together here, essentially, and saying there is the side that goes away from the light. And yeah, there's other parts wedging in there. It's more complicated than that. But he is thinking of not just the torso, not just the thorax, but the thorax and the pelvis wedged together. Maybe a little bit of a different position for that pelvis. So that it goes like this and then like that, maybe. And then he says, I know that shape goes, and that makes a big, strong figure. And then you say, but what about all this stuff that got interrupted? He can put a leg onto that and cover that stuff up and put another leg behind it. And you'll work all that stuff out later. It can't be done. Figure drawing cannot be mastered with the details if the big parts aren't working. Okay. Fill up this chart. Fill up this chart with 40 figure drawings and 120 as simple boxes that you can see through. If you can turn them into something a little more organic, do. And then when you come in next Thursday, I may show some of the ones that the people are getting crit give, but if you've got people who will work with you, you will learn faster. And then we're going to shift gears, not into technical things, not into stuff about X, Y, and Z axes and coronal, sagittal, and transverse sections, but into what the body is doing. We're going to move into the gestural part of this. And I am now hitting the return button so that you will get a link. Go to the chat. There is a link from me to a YouTube video where I show Louis de Brat, who gave me permission to broadcast his animal analysis critique. Okay, thank you for being here. If you're feeling lost and you feel like you need help, some of you are going to get help from me in an hour. The rest of you, I hope you've got other people that you're studying this with. You can get together and talk about it. You can share resources. You can practice together. You can give yourself feedback. And the great secret that we talked about earlier, the great secret is, if you can this week, remind yourself, I get no credit for this. This is not a college course where I get to get a diploma. I'm doing this because I'm interested in it. I want to enjoy it. This is my work of choice. Everybody else is doing other things. I'm going to enjoy learning the three forms of the figure and putting them in different directions and then looking at Bridgman drawings until I have, in a matter of a week, sucked up all of the wisdom and knowledge about constructing figures of the three big forms that I can. And then we're going to move into a much more sensory, sensational, emotional aspect of it, of why would you place them in those positions? What's this character doing? Okay, thanks. See ya. That was session 3 on form from our 12-session bootcamp in 2020. If you want more videos, live sessions, and updates on other offerings, subscribe to my announcement list at martialart.com.